1954. Sock hops. I like Ike. And television comes to the heart of Carolina.
The first cameras we had, we'd have to take the lens and rotate them. And he said, quick, give me a tight shot. Well, you'd have to flip it, and sometimes you'd rotate it on the air, and that was not good.
We tried to do things the best we could under the circumstances. We were the Wright brothers. Now this is the Concord.
WTVD, a part of the heart of Carolina for 30 years. In the winter of 1953, the television industry was still wet behind the ears. And so, when on Christmas Eve of that year, the Durham Morning Herald reported the news that a long, hard battle between broadcasting companies competing for the license to operate a TV station in Durham had finally been resolved, the entire Durham County and surrounding communities crackled with an excitement that has yet to be equaled in the past 31 years. Those were special times. Ernie Greup, the station's first program director, remembers.
They were hectic, but they were interesting and exciting. Along with Harmon Duncan, the late Harmon Duncan, and Floyd Fletcher, and the staff that we were assembling, it was the great move to bring something exciting and something new, our own, our very own, here in the Durham area, and trying to plan what our local news coverage would be, how we could reach out into the community, our total viewing area, and also fixing the old building. That was a very important thing. And so often we were doing things and people were on the telephone and bang, 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 construction going on, the dust falling down, and transforming the building into a good television studio.
The new station's facility, an abandoned building which had formerly housed the county's tuberculosis sanatorium, had been the subject of much debate among city fathers. But the mood of the times was reflected in the final decision to begin leasing negotiations with the owners of the new television license when Chamber of Commerce Chairman Frank Pearson told a group of community leaders that Durham Broadcasting Enterprises is interested in the property. If they get it, we'll have TV in Durham sooner. 6:45 p.m. on September 2nd, 1954, they got it.
The first thing that went on the air was the National Anthem, Star Spangled Banner, and that was from the Air Force. We had an exciting time with that. We had suggested to the Air Force, they wanted to know what they might be able to do to help us. And he said, can you get us the Star Spangled Banner? And he said, yes, they could. Well, time went on and we didn't hear, and it got to be, I think, the morning of the day we were going on the air, September 2nd. And so we called the Air Force and we said, that film isn't here yet. Now, can you imagine? We've really planned all these people who would be watching Channel 11 come on the air. Well, let me tell you, they made a hurried call to Georgia. The film arrived by special jet. There was a siren escort into the station. It got there about within an hour of the time we went on the air.
In the beginning, we had no network when they signed on the air in 1954. When I was promotion manager here at TVD, we were one of two stations in the country that had both the CBS and NBC affiliates. And we were promoted, a little thing we put together, as the best of the two best.
This is what put us on the air, a relic by today's standards, like much of the old equipment which still stands at the Garner transmitter site. Equipment which has long since been replaced by more modern, sophisticated electronics.
And now, here he is, the one, the only...
The technology of television is old hat to today's switched-on, tuned-in audience. But imagine, if you will, that in 1954, it was nothing short of magic, as you bet your life, with the inimitable Groucho Marx, whose radio program had long since been an established entertainment hit, became the first program broadcast on the new television station, WTVD, Channel 11.
Groucho Marx, he was a very funny man. Of course, he will live forever, I think, in syndication. This was an extremely funny person.
From one old timer to another. Happy birthday, WTVD.
Sock hops. I like Ike. And television comes to the heart of Carolina.
It was all live. eyes, no videotape, no film. What you saw is what you saw. That was it.
I was running the boom, and I swung it so quick that I turned the whole boom right over on the show. You know, even though it's black and white television, my face was just as red as blood.
WTVD, a part of the heart of Carolina for 30 years. '50s television was live television. The pace was frantic, but the rewards were great. Fun and excitement marked those early years in which the resourcefulness and quick thinking of the small staff at WTVD rescued the station from many a crisis, both big and small.
Well, it was absolutely flying by the seat of your pants. I mean, there was no videotape. Everything was black and white. Everything was live. You'd be switching a break at night. You'd come out of the news, you'd do your break, you'd have 30 minutes to set up a live commercial in the studio with live talent. After that commercial on the next break, you'd tear it down, set up another commercial. Just a tremendous workload for the crew. And I guess what's really impressive is the equipment we had and the small staff we had, the job we were able to do. We were a very close group, very dedicated group. Everything we did, you know, was instantaneous and live. We were radio with pictures back then. And, you know, just a tremendous experience.
Good morning, boys and girls, and welcome to the Cartoon Shop. And I'm the Toy Soldier, and we have, a delightful program for you today, including...
Oh, we had a good deal more local programming than we do now, certainly. We had an hour show five mornings a week called the Cartoon Shop. We were all stars, really, whether we wanted to be or not. We would, for instance, I was hired as secretary to the program manager, but soon found that I was a couple of puppets on the cartoon show. I was Daryl Donkey and Teresa Tiger. Teresa, I was my own voice. Daryl Donkey, I said, good morning, like that.
I remember I was Crawford Crowe. I was never seen, but if a piece of paper or something dropped on the set, oh, Crawford, did you drop that? That's what the toy soldier would say. And I was also the bunny rabbit a couple of times because he was sick, because his legs would stretch out a little long and they would fold up, and the public really should have realized that the legs were more wrinkled with me than they were with the tall rabbit. And some of the puppets would get sick and you'd play the puppets. Tom Turkey, Ernie would make me gobble quite a few times, even though sometimes I was upset and didn't want to gobble. Ernie said, if you know what's good for you, you will gobble.
It was the grandest thing in the world to be employed by WTVD. It was like being the president of the United States. People, you couldn't believe it. They'd ask you where you worked, and they would ask you 1,000 questions. It was amazing. I just couldn't believe it. It was really like being a celebrity.
Boys, let's get it here with a little tune called Alabama Jubilee.
Jim Thornton was a country musician. He was, I believe, from Benson. And at that time was very big. And we used to have a live program on Saturday night. There would be people lined up out in the parking lots. We finally had to get a security guard. People would come in and just really cut up, whatever. He was just, if you knew him, you would never forget. He was a personality. I mean, he would do most anything. He had a commercial for dog food. I think it was Yellow Rose, the best I remember. That may be wrong. He used to eat dog food on the air. Said if it was good enough for him, it was good enough for your dog.
'54, Sock House, I Like Ike, and television comes to the heart of Carolina.
Running camera, we were able to eat the food that Peggy cooked. And you know, being an old country boy, I was always used to potatoes and tomatoes and corn and butter bean. But I never knew what a casserole was until Peggy cooked.
She was a pioneer. A lot of things were not talked about in public. She talked about them and brought to help bring them the problems of today into the fore.
Her success far exceeded anything we had in mind for a, quote, cooking show, which it was far more than that, the way Peggy had it.
She was a great person, a great part of the television history of this station and this state.
WTVD, a part of the heart of Carolina for 30 years.
The City Service Oil Company and your local City Service distributor, offering you a full range of quality City Service products, presents 11th Hour Report, a complete roundup of news, sports, and weather with Fred Blackman.
Good evening, everybody. The president holds a news conference and speaks out on Cuba.
Bringing the news of the world and the heart of Carolina into the living rooms of those early viewers was no easy task. By the early 60s, when this newscast was recorded, we had entered the realm of seasoned, experienced professionals. But in the very beginning, sheer grit and determination to succeed was the glue that held the evening news together. It was a never-ending nightmare of near misses and heart-racing dashes to meet the deadline before the evening news.
Jack West was the SO reporter. At that time, we had a news department of about three or four people, and Jack came in the afternoon and read the news at 6 o'clock. And my first recollection of Jack was that, gee, he sure is short, because all the time that I had seen him on TV, I thought he must have been about 6'4".
Film, drying film on a little squirrel cage. We didn't have all the sophisticated equipment. We didn't have the satellites. To get news from Fayetteville, it had to come up on the bus, and sometimes that took days almost. Or we had to go and try to meet a cameraman, reporter, down in Fuquay Varina.
So we would shoot 5 to 10 stories a day, and we would, it being on film, we would do our own processing, and the processing machine, and we would do our own editing and on all the stories. If we shot it, we'd do the editing. And the reporter would tell us, you know, he wants 30 seconds of the good stuff. And that's what we did. We tried to pull out the good stuff. But we would stay out and shoot several stories at the time, you know, and then come back in lunchtime and say what we shot. We subscribed to the UPI film clips, and they would send them by plane the same day that we would need them. And I would take the company car, which was a station wagon at the time, and go to the airport to pick the film up, and I would help the people at the airport look for the film clips. Even I'd crawl up in the belly of the airplane and get the film clips out, and I look at the watch, and it's almost 6 o'clock, and our news starts at 6. And I'm driving back at 110, 115 miles an hour, and I run across to Whammy, and Floyd Fletcher, which was the president at the time, met me at the door and said, after you get the film on the air, I want to talk to you. So I knew something was wrong. So the patrolman had called him and said, I'm not running him, I'm just telling you, tell him not to do that no more. So it didn't really stop us from doing it. He said it wasn't important enough to get tickets and kill yourself over, but we thought it was.
1 year ago, on October the 15th, I shared an experience with several thousand North Carolina women. Surgery for breast cancer. Today I'm...
It was undoubtedly the late Peggy Mann who embodied the spirit of WTVD in those exciting early days. Peggy Mann, who captured the admiration and respect of the heart of Carolina in her many years at Channel 11.
I had the pleasure of directing the Peggy Mann Show for a good number of years, and I guess some of the most important happenings at TVD was done on that particular show. Peggy Mann was probably one of the most dynamic personalities I've ever been associated with. She was a type of individual that everyone could relate to, everyone could believe, everyone could learn from. She was a tireless worker in the community. She just was a tremendous asset to the station.
She
she had the viewers, Kathy. The mail, you just wouldn't believe the people that wrote in for the recipes and the sewing sheets that she offered. Then the recipes at Christmas and Thanksgiving were always great. They just really wrote in for those. And to do those, she would offer them about the first of the week, and I would try to get them out by the last of the week, and I would have to take some of it home to get my husband to help me stuff it so I could get them out on time.
This kind of dedication to the community, which began at the very start of WTVD and has continued through all the many changes in news and public affairs programs, is what endeared WTVD to the heart of Carolina, and the heart of Carolina to WTVD.
Our top story on Eyewitness News at 6, a fire here at WTVD.
That became self-evident when on Sunday, March the 4th, 1979, the station's facilities went up in flames, and the entire community turned out to offer their assistance to Durham's first television station.
From Raleigh, happy birthday, WTVD.
I think without question, TVD has been a real moving force in this community. Television itself is a very intrusive, very powerful medium. Used improperly, you could be in a lot of trouble. But TVD, their standards, their prior management, their present management, we've always, Cap City's parent company, we all believe in doing the best job we can do. And this is the way it's worked through the years.
I can't remember when you were there. My life around the sweetest days.
I think, were the beneficiaries. Peggy put it, the late Peggy Mann put it very well when she said she learned from our viewers and from the staff, and I agree with her 100%.